as said, I'm from Aalto University, from the School of Art and Design. And I'm a doctoral candidate there in Media Lab. Well, my research topic is to understand the change of landscape of audiovisual media. And I'm concentrating in my presentation also in audiovisual media. And I initiated this seminar to Jonas and some others because when I joined the community here at Medea, I noticed that we are actually, many of us are talking about media design. And there has been a lot of literature about around media design and the different understandings and characteristics, what does it actually mean. But I, in my research and studies, I've noticed that the people have different kinds of understandings, and therefore I initiated this seminar, and actually I would like this to be more participatory and interactive seminar, so we could actually together map the what do we mean by media design. This is what I propose for the content of the seminar. I would give a short introduction of how I see the media design and the different characteristics, and some I will summarize some of the different studies, also the literature that was sent with the invitation. And then I would like us to do some mapping together and discuss about these different issues together. And then if we are really productive, maybe we can come up with some strategies and principles and methods together, how to actually approach this media design. And how this actually relates to my doctoral research is that I'm claiming in my research that I am media designer, and so therefore I need to understand what is media design. And well, this is, can you see, yeah. Well, this is the traditional view of how media was created, and media texts and media content. Media professionals did that to and share it and distribute it to audiences. And this is how the designer was traditionally see that designer's task was to make formats and structures and different platforms for this media content that was created by media professionals, and then people of like former users were actually using it and understanding it. Well, everybody knows what happened. Of course, the digitalizations made effective and communication and media tools for available for everyone. So everybody was able to make media productions and so forth. And the abundance of media online has made our usage of media really different. There is the tools for production and creation, and there is abundance of video materials online. And then it has created a novel way of people to process, assimilate, and appropriate information through and with audiovisual content and media. There has been a lot of studies and research on what actually people do online with audiovisual media or with media content. One of my favorite examples of these compilations is this do-it-yourself video, a group and a conference or summit that gathers practitioners, researchers, and designers together. And I think they have two different sets of videos. They have created, collected videos, and made some ethnographic work online to compile what are the different genres of do-it-yourself video. Because we're not talking about today what actually is the media content and what people are doing. I'm only going to show you one example that I really like myself. This is one example of their collection.
Whatever happens, we one take only, no matter what.
One take jump.
But I do suggest we all come towards the middle, towards the end. Ready?
Yeah.
The song.
I am the one desire, believe when I say I want it that way. But we are two worlds apart, can't reach to your heart when you say that I want it that way. Tell me why.
Co-workers, they in the office, it's titled, and they are using a Skype connection of iChat, I don't know actually what is the program they're using, to record the song and doing lip sync. They only use their everyday tools to make this work, and it was quite amazing. There is a lot of those different examples of variations, like not people not only making their video content or content, but also utilizing and the existing everyday software that they use in their office. So media design. What is to design media? Is it actually the medium or to design another medium that is its content? One of the articles that was sent within the invitation was the only one that I found that was talking about media design and designing media. To be honest, I was not so impressed by the article, but I chose it because it has a great initiative in a way to opening up this discussion. There is a lot of discussion about going, what is media design? And actually there are plenty of university programs that actually educate designers or media designers. And I have actually one example of the professor talking about what is media design. I don't know if I have time to show it, but I can summarize what he says and share the link afterwards. It's only focusing on the interaction and software design or application or tools and so forth, not at all at the media design itself or media as a content or the social interactions, what is underlining with the media. This was one other example of the article that I picked. It's this book about designing media. And its approach to media design is that it gives the media professionals and entrepreneurs the voice how to design media. But it all lacks quite strongly the people's point of view or the use activities, what actually people are doing. And the third one that I chose was this Bastard Culture. It's called the title of the book. I find it really a relevant book because I think it's one of the critical voices of the how to approach participation culture and how to talk about the participation in context of design. This is my way of trying to map the media design. I claim that the media designers and media professionals are coming together in a way, or they should collaborate, or the media designers could have and should have the skills to actually to make the content. And by content, I mean also the media texts and the media artifacts, and also the software-based systems and, for example, participation platforms. And, for example, the design interactions and design systems, and that would also include the content. So the content and the creation of the content are emerging together. That is my claim. And I have made plenty of examples to show. I hope you agree. So the emerging field of media design requires integration of various disciplines and understandings of media text. Media designers need to understand the different genres and formats. And when we are actually doing media design, then we need to also take into account of the content in a way. And of course, there's a lot of different words for people, users, former users, these people who are actually also creating content and enriching the content. They're like pro ams, lead beaters, concept, and so forth. But I just wanted to choose a really generic word for the public because it also has consumers and citizens and so forth. So the content and the creations actually are in this evolving loop. It's a never-ending loop. And I claim also that when we are actually analyzing and studying media texts, that we cannot, the process is never ending. And I will show you in a few minutes what I mean about that. Because I believe that in this new ecosystem of media and tools and systems, it's a never-ending loop where public actually participates. And these media designers and also the public takes part in designing these practices, genres, tools, functions, and structures in a way. For example, the participation platforms, for example, YouTube, gives a lot of different possibilities to people to give tools to make metadata and create comments and leave video comments and so forth. And if we have a closer look of the content, here I have tried to make another kind of a framework to illustrate the never-ending cycle of media content and how people are interpreting, appropriating, and reinventing the content in a constant loop. And it goes back in this review, rethink, and remix cycle. And I believe that this has become the cornerstones activities of our online culture today. And a lot of studies, for example, on YouTube has shown that people's online activities are manifold and that they're creatively adopting and developing these new practices and new uses. And this is just a condensed illustration of the framework and the different levels of activities. And what we as designers, at least sometimes I, forget these different levels of participation. How can we facilitate people that not all of them are actually making remixes, but some are making comments or tags or making their own personal archives, they're leaving video comments and so forth. And how do we find this ways of facilitating all these levels of participation and use activities. In one of the articles that was given in this context of the invitation, I think there was mentioned that 70% of people online are actually creating content in some form, metadata or giving a tags or so forth, or creating audiovisual remixes. That is quite a lot of people. And people are not only doing this voluntarily in a way that I would be actively seeking, going to, like, I want to participate now and I want to make content. But when even accessing video online in YouTube or other video sharing services, the system collects data of me and it gives like the count of views and so forth. One other way of seeing this use activities and what people do, this is from an article that I co-wrote together with my two colleagues. It was also in the email. It's called Expanding Design Space, Design in Use Activities and Strategies. And this highlights the different activities that people have, not only doing creating the content, but they have these social agreements. People are creating workarounds, they are misusing the content and so forth. And it's seen on the left side here, the different activities. And on the right side, there is some supporting strategies, how we as a designers or media scholars or interaction designers should or could facilitate and support these different kinds of activities. I don't go into detail because it's explained in the article quite well. But one example I could give this, for example, in this social agreements, I think most known example is Twitter's hashtags, that it was not actually designed by the designers of Twitter. It was designed by the user community, and then they found a new ways of using it and misusing it to organize the data better. There are some examples that I would like to show you to start the discussion in a way. Oopapa, sorry about that. That I would like to share with you. This one is about the social agreement, and this is an artist, a musician who wanted to make a music video with together with the fans or people online. So they were asked to participate in a predefined form, and it has been, as you can see, how many views it has and how many people actually participated in the creation of media. And it's amazing how people actually are contributing in a predefined manner, and they want to be part of this kind of collaborative effort of media design. And creatively using the technology or the framing and the way of actually creating the content using the tools available in every home or every computer they have. There are lots of these same kind of examples. What is interesting in this, because this is more creating the content and not the form or the structures itself, but when it is in YouTube, it has created a lot of subgenres, and people are actually copying the format. So as a, when we are as a designers doing an act, are we actually creating a format of different kind of new media content? And I've seen at least 10, 15 similar kinds of projects, because they are copying one of another. So when we are doing the designs, we are not only creating the content, but we are contributing to the genre. The other example is, one could say that it's a traditional remix. It's a political remix that one guy wanted to make. I can show you. It's using 50 different clips of Donald Duck's adventures. It's about
the feeling, and you're not alone.
The income gap between rich and poor in America is at an 80-year high. That's the largest differential.
50 classic Walt Disney cartoons. And because of the, his life is not doing so well because of the economic crisis.
Government isn't helping.
And
decades of rising
with
inequality.
The voiceover and so forth. It's been viewed 1 million times, and it's already translated into 6 different languages since October 2010. Why I want to show you this is because we see all these remixes and political voices and how people want to take part in the society and so forth. But what I find really interesting is that the same artist or activist has tried another kind of a platform, an approach to the same video. He has used the HTML5 video demo that utilizes the popcorn JavaScript and so forth to give context to the video, where the actual source materials are, what is in Wikipedia, what are the other data sources. So this creates a completely different experience for the person who is actually watching it, giving it more context, giving it the history, and one can actually navigate through the links. I can show you. And giving the audio source and footnotes, and
hola,
one can get
Mex-America.
Comments. And as you can see, it changes while the remix is playing. So, and this is, I think, it really a good example of new kind of media design. When you actually, video is not only a black box online anymore. It's actually connected to other data sources, and it can actually reveal the sources and audio and could and it's changing all the time. If somebody is making Wikipedia entry or using the same tag, actually it would change the experience.
Everything.
The other example that I would like to share with you is about data visualization. It has the same characteristics as the previous example, but it also has the a new form of giving creating a story, and this is more in a scholarly context, this example. And also it's it has the same fundamental idea that it has a different way of navigating through media. He has made chapters.
We are research scientists here at IBM.
And you can see that in the bottom of the video, you
more
can see the related information, background information about
the
people who are interviewed, related
everyone,
links,
anyone.
Twitter
One
feeds,
that
Flickr
that
flows,
right,
all the data
sort of
that one can aggregate with
this
application interfaces. And then you can navigate through back and forth and add your own comments
anyone can
to
go
the text.
It's up in public and for free. You can put your data up and visualize.
So this
quite
you clearly
can, if you have an Excel spreadsheet,
changes
something of interest, or you can
the
write
experience
something up in a little bit
of
processor,
how we understand the video and interviews.
And
I have seen examples
of, you know,
that if the interviewer has made a mistake, one can go and actually change it and make a comment or box. Oops, I was mistaken. I got new information. So also this is constantly
to the outside
evolving
so what visualization
media
is doing
content.
It's just and it's taking advantage of the fact that
it would not be the same without the structures and the functionalities that are embedded in this experience.
I think the best way for people to learn about visualizations is
also, I recommend this video anyway, because it's quite interesting about the data visualization and how it's used in journalism.
And so Google has a new product, which we hope will be helpful to us, as they do too.
Let's move along with the examples. This I don't have to probably show online. Al Jazeera is probably you all know. So what they did just recently is that they had launched their own Twitter dashboard. So it means that visitors online and their page, they can interactively see what issues being tweeted in which country, and actually drawing the visualization of the current topic, and in which country, which topic, which hashtag, and so forth. So giving another layer of the media content, but still in a comprehensive form. So here again, I see a role as a media designer, how to actually create interface and interactions between these different services and data sets that can be presented to the audience, and how to make it as open that people would actually like to participate. Another example, and the same news company or media company. Another way of telling a story, Revolution in 18 Days. It's quite straightforward, going back and forth different days, and has time what actually has happened, and also using other data sets and so forth. But what I find interesting, this is the same event, 18 days in Egypt, and a group of people have started a collaborative documentary about the revolution. And they've asked people to participate, to send not to anything out of the ordinary, just tweeting, but use the hashtags that they have in each day and so forth. And then they would use this to create the documentary together. Here I see, as a media designer, how to create a format and a call for participation that would actually be meaningful for the people. And also then to see the end result, that how can it be. I'm going to show you, this is, they only have at the moment a demo of their project or the documentary, but I think it's so nice that I actually want to show it to you. But remember, this is only a demonstration. I think it was done in March or February, so this is a really recent project. And you can go on top, get more information, pictures that the people have posted in Flickr or Twitter. Also connected to other news services, you could say to mass media services and private media. What I see here is as a challenge is that now when we have this abundance of media content, pictures, videos and so forth, and other data, how do we actually deliver it, or how do we are making this kind of a form that it would be a good experience? And who am I to say what would be the good experience? Maybe we should have them all open so everybody could make their own kinds of documentary. I'm almost done with my examples, just a few more, because my own interest is in audiovisual archives and how to use existing audiovisual media. This is creating meaningful access to video archives. This is the US Congress, and they have all their videos online, and they have transcribed and so forth. So you can actually navigate through the text and find it. This is another example of Cultural Heritage Institution, and the project is called Digital Vaults. You can pick whatever item, and the whole items are actually, it's difficult to explain. I'm going to show it to you. I tried Sweden. So this is also a different kinds of kind of as you can see, based on the metadata, it rearranges all the media content from their archives and make these new connections between different items. And you can search and navigate through these different items and create your own path through the to the media and so forth. And they even have this great page that they could people can create movies or posters and so forth in their own as they please. It's a really really interesting project. And here again, it's a different way of representation of media, different way of creating an experience, and giving an open way to people participate to the content. There are many of these collaborative film video projects online. This is I'm not going to show you the Finnish one, the Stravrek, but I'm going to show you this cosmonaut one, because I just recently heard a presentation of one of the directors or people in the project, and what struck me was that actually they were not only doing a film, they were creating experiences on and offline, and creating a community that people wanted to actually take part in these parties. They organized parties, and people wanted to buy t-shirts. So this actually, this media content is expanding to our everyday lives, and it goes across not only the media that we are creating for this project, but it's kind of it's also a part of our identity. So a few marks about this content and creation, and how actually the structures and the medium is embedded to this whole process. And I claim that one cannot actually separate this. Open-ended and continuous process. Bruns, who's known about his development of idea of producers, people becoming from being not producers, but also being in this collaborative process of creation. He says in his paper that this process is iterative, and it's an evolution, and it's gradually improve the content that the community shares. In our own work and in the paper that I briefly mentioned earlier, we've also noticed that this open-endedness and leaving space for the content and also the structures to be opened, it attracts more participation. Also, this flexible agency. There are various levels of participation and engagement. Some people want to only put tags, somebody wants to make a video, somebody wants to create their own part of the music video and so forth. But also it should be remembered that the participation can be explicit or implicit, that we should also take into account these implicit media practices that people have. And the Schaefer in his Bastard Culture book is talking about this, for example. Design in use activities. Of course, Pelle En has written quite a lot of about this, and for example, in his article Participation in Design Things. And also, these design in use activities should be recognized, and how people are actually using and designing at the same time in various ways, and how can we support this in our content and creation and when we are designing the forms. Media and technology are interconnected. They cannot be separated anymore, I claim. And also these user activities are now embedded in the software design. Therefore, it's crucial for the media designers to understand the fundamentals of media and media content when they are creating web applications and so forth. And also, it was a good notion of Schaefer again that these technical designs of computers, internet, and software reveal social values of the designers, and either stimulates or represses various media practices. We can support them or we can repress them. There are many more, and I would like to hear your comments if you had some before I continue. Do you have anything that you would like to add here? Now start the interactive part of the session.
Well, I'm thinking one thing, I mean, you mentioned agency, which is the human part. But I'm thinking a lot of the time there's quite a bit of work of community building, the social stuff, which is maybe missing in those. But I think that's often a very important part.
Yeah.
So.
I agree.
I mean, I think those are good, you know, open-ended, flexible agency design and use. But that, I would add, I don't know what the heading would be. But
yeah, I agree that the social element and that the community is really, really important. When I started my research, I had the concept of communities of media practice. I started to investigate like how the communities are actually in the participation platforms and what kinds of activities they have there and so forth. But further along, when I studied more, I understood that many of the communities actually are built around some media object or the project or a need. So I'm now a bit hesitant of using the community word, but the social aspect is really important.
Because I think there's a lot of agreements being done there around the creation conventions.
Yeah.
Thinking around genres, formats, or all those things. That may becomes to some degree invisible. If you're not part of it, you don't see it.
And also that there is that what people do this make social agreements and they are creating workarounds, and those soft designs, as we call them, they're not visible if you're not actually following the practice of people or are not involved with those agreements or circumstances of what people do. So I agree. There is one thing that I want to show you. I thought that I'm not going to show you this because off topic, but it's like different ways of design traditionally we design for usability and sociability, policies, practices, and how to enhance the socialness and the communities and their own practices already. And what I would like to suggest also to addition to this is the design for designability. These social aspects, but also how to provide resources and processes and tools actually people to design themselves and take more initiative in soft designs or this hard design, core design, if you know, if you have the skills of doing the actual programming and so forth and so forth, but also the soft designs.
Can I pick up on this?
Yes. Please.
Social aspects, community building, those kinds of things. Based on my experience, there seems to be some kind of spectrum, though. I mean, for some domains, purposes, communities, as a designer, as a media designer, you have to do a lot of work on the non-technical levels just to make things happen, to catalyze, to facilitate, to stimulate. I've said this before, but the Avatopia project we did some time ago, I think we spent 60-70% of the resources on non-technical activities that were necessary to kind of encourage this community to come into existence. But in other domains, there seems to be a much more intrinsic readiness or urge to engage, to participate. If you were to, you know, set up a successful dating site, for example, you don't need to spend 10 cents doing socially oriented things, events, what have you. It's going to happen anyway, because users are more inclined to engage in certain things than in other things. So is that an important dimension here as well? When we talk about social aspects and the importance of community building and stuff like that, that it may be different depending on what kind of topic you work on, what kind of community you work for, or hope to create. I suppose it's like any kind of activism, really. You just want to support activism in an area where people are already, you know, ready to act. All you need to do is to hold up a sign, and people will follow you. But in some other areas, you need to do more proactive work. I don't know where this goes, really. It's just a modification, perhaps, of the notion of working on the level of social aspects.
Yeah, I mean, my point was just that that's an important thing, and then it depends on what type of social, like you say.
Yeah.
There are very different types.
I was thinking about another bullet here, maybe. Power.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of implied in the media and technology interconnected point, but maybe it deserves its own bullet here. Because there, in many cases, there seems to be this sense that the media designer creates an arena, sets a stage, so to speak, and provides props or tools for people to act on that stage. But when creating the stage, you also kind of decide what you expect to happen there. You make certain things easy by providing tools and interfaces and connections, but you make other things almost impossible because you did not include those kinds of tools and props. So Twitter streams or Flickr feeds or whatever. So there is always this notion of power. I mean, this is clearly not rocket science, but
seems like something that should be acknowledged, and that perhaps some of the writers on prosumer culture and stuff like that are a little too idealistic about it, maybe.
That was actually one of the things that Schaeffer in his Bastard Culture book rose up at that, because there has been this hype of participation culture, and people want to participate, and it's this kind of collective force that everybody has the power to participate, and it's a democratic process, and it's not actually. And different policymakers and different laws are actually regulating it, and many different stakeholders have many various agendas that they want to push. So definitely the power and also the ethical questions that we have should be considered.
One thing I'm thinking about, if you could say more about, because it's a question that I struggle with, this design and use, where to draw the line, because when software or the technology and the content, where do you draw the line between design or what you call, or is it important to draw the line between design and appropriation? Because I'm thinking, like the example with rock or the collaborative rock video. I mean, he's pretty much setting up this kind of media protocol, like how should you be in the frame and this and that. And I think that's, when I'm teaching interaction design, I try to get my students to think about those things, like that's an important element in the design. And it, to some degree, I can see it as a design element. And the same thing is like how you, if you're filming as a non-professional or as a professional, the way you hold the camera and what becomes the kind of mise-en-scene or whatever, the stage, you can control quite quickly and redefine what is being shown. For example, in when we did Login, we did this video report. There, the participants who were cultural workers, they would set up, stage things and tape up things and create this scene, just like big media professionals, which I saw actually at the time, Sydsvenskan, for example, they appropriated this teenage tent and then cut out their logos, because the youth organization we had worked with, RGRA, they Sydsvenskan needed teenagers because that would look good for their report. But they wanted to stage it as a Sydsvenskan report. And then they wanted to cut out RGRA. So they cut out, they had function and stuff hanging around, but by just simply. And that's it's a quite heavy, you could say, design by, the way that what you choose should enter the frame.
Yeah.
Both on that level and also with the rock video, like how you script what you say, how should people behave and so forth. Is that, would you call that design and use, or would you call that something
and
else?
I think it's, if you really pinpointed what I am trying to say, is that because in media creation, there is this different formats or genres or different kind of framing, as you said, and we are setting the stage and we are in the shoulders of the giant, of course, because we are always somehow reusing the same ideas and that everybody else, so we are adapting, or we can reproduce the same formats that some media companies have, or we can take another approach and misuse it. But also I think there is this evolution that in the design use is also in design of the media content and how you frame it, but also then how it's represented in context of other services or applications.
But I mean, it's such a simple thing, just the way you hold the camera.
Yeah.
If you want to point it this direction or that direction.
Yeah,
or
the camera
if you move it 2 centimeters down,
yeah,
and that cuts out some important element. I mean, and so you can redefine totally what is being broadcasted by these very simple things.
Yeah. And camera angles and lighting and everything.
Yeah.
That's why it's a, the media design, it's essential to understand the practice of creating media,
mm-hmm,
and especially audiovisual media, because one needs to understand the framing, for example, or how to analyze media. Yeah.
How does that sense of design relate to more conventional notions of design or interactions?
Well, my question is, like, how are we to talk about this?
Exactly.
Is it design? Is it design, or is it, or should we talk about it? But I think interaction designers, they need to, like you say, they need to understand this and the power of it, and be aware of it, and think about it. And I think, you know, when you're setting up some kind of media project together with people, you need to discuss these issues and how you do, and also follow up on it. I don't know if it's important here to design if it's some, you know, to define it as design or this other thing, but it's definitely an element that an interaction designer, they cannot discard this and say, well, that's just for the camera people, or that's for the content providers, or whatever, because it can totally reshape everything that you've been working on. So it's definitely an issue that, again, interaction designers need to be sensitized to, but I don't know, again, I don't know if it's important to call it design and use or something else. That's another question.
Yeah, why I chose to say design is because I believe that we also design moving images, for example. It's a creation and design of moving images. So therefore I say design rather than creation, and I don't want to use the word user generated, because it's I don't think it's generated, it's created. So of course there's still some, I'm a bit vague in my terminology, but I think I'm now leaning to use design more than creation.
I have had a few moments of comedy in the Substrate project, which is about product information. Well, I've worked with technical writers, information architects at this large company, who are thinking about ways of using video as a new form of product information, you know, user manuals, instructions, stuff like that. And what they did, at least initially, was to think about it as some kind of binary variable. You know, like, okay, either we can write text about this, or we can make a video. And that was, you know, that was the choice. Not a word about how to make the video. What would it show? What would be the tone? How would it be produced? What kind of implied stories would it contain? It was just, okay, we can swap this text for video, and we will get so much more compelling documentation,
yeah,
and people will want to use it again. And I was like, maybe not. Depends on the video, you know. So, yeah, at least in the industry, or some less developed parts of the industry, there is this complete ignorance of the design that goes into producing video. It's treated like a binary variable. Choose your modality here: text, video, speech. Pick one, use some heuristics, done.
Yeah.
And that's a little scary, I think.
And also in language of moving images and understanding it, because what with my examples I try to show is that we have seen the video and audiovisual media as a black box. It's been just a frame. It's like being like a TV there. And now we are going to another emerging field that we can actually break that black box. We can bring other elements to it. And therefore, we need to have a new set of this moving language of moving images, how to analyze it, because it's we're not going to have a ready-made media text that we could actually say, okay, now this film is one that one can analyze, and so forth. And it's never ending, but you've been trying to say for some time.
Well, it's more a question of the characteristics you give here. Is this purely descriptive? Is there normative elements in this? Is this the way it is, or is this the way it should be?
I think it's how it should be, and what the examples that I have chosen that it is also. But why I left the question mark is that there is other characteristics or issues that needs to be also mapped. So this is an ongoing process for me. And also, because I take a quite strong stance as a designer to facilitate and be a part of this open culture project, so I think my own activism is somehow visible here, of course. And I cannot say that this is how it should be, but these are what my findings have been.
What about a national concept of quality? Does that, is that something part of your way of thinking or discussing or theorizing?
Quality in a way that how it's significant for the people that take part in the process, not as a quality of the snapshot of the process or the media aspect. I don't look at the aesthetics values, for example, at all, that I have. I think it would be quite a challenge. Oh, it might be. It's a good point that I have to somehow disclose that or make it understandable that I don't actually.
I think quality is really crucial, but I think that saying good or bad, I think it's more interesting to look at it like intersubjectivity, or like within the group, how do they define quality and how do they define it in relationship to then other groups? Because that's again something we saw that working with the teenagers, they were comparing and sometimes talking down to their own stuff because it didn't have like three camera angles. So it wasn't SVT quality or like professional quality, and therefore it wasn't as legitimate. So that kind of, I mean, so they are defining quality within the group, but they're also relating it to other groups or other media practices or genres.
And other communities, for example,
because
I've been looking at the different urban communities that they actually are doing or creating media to show off to other communities and building their own identity and so forth.
Yeah, I was going to say that if you look at it purely as something being negotiated within the group, you kind of miss half the point, which is that what this little group does in their basement somewhere is visible to the whole world and potentially relevant and interesting and meaningful to a much, much, much larger audience than any previous mass media kind of product. Which means that the notion of quality must necessarily have those two levels, I think. The internal kind of level, but also the being aware that we are viewed from the outside, identity building, projecting a message kind of level at the same time. Otherwise it would be kind of a pointless notion of quality, I think. But maybe I'm wrong here.
No, when I started my university studies, my first MA, I remember when I was doing my first film analysis, and I remember that I was looking at the shadows and the lights, the camera techniques, and so forth. And I still have seen some media scholars using the same methods approaching the current media. And I agree, I would say that those methods of analyzing does not apply anymore, this type of media content. One is that it's like I said, it's an iterative process. You can only take snapshots of one media artifact. It's not like, well, there are some collaborative projects that the film is the end result. But also the way of they've been created, and they have a different kinds of language in a way, I would say. I have to think about it and give you a better answer, because it's my intuitive strong feeling that cannot be done, but I would need to find more arguments.
What can be done?
The same kind of analysis and the study of media artifacts that it has been.
But not the same kind, but perhaps a retooling of analytical concepts and tools, how you can look upon Christopher Shea's station. And when you talk about power, I mean, there's a lot of film theorists doing a lot of good work on the power perspective of film and visual images. So
and
it's really important.
And also film as a social practice.
Because, since you talked about film visualization as a black box, I mean, that's really strange for me, because people have been working on film for so long, so that's not a black box at all. Not in that kind of, in that research field. So.
No, not in that way, but I've meant in video as a black box on the internet, that it has been a frame that is not being connected to other media forms, like text has been. We have had hyperlinks and navigation, and in that sense, I meant not, of course, film and media itself are in the society, and it's not isolated from its audiences or practices.
Maybe I'm saying talking too much.
No.
But I think one thing relating to this analysis has to do with, I mean, a lot of it is a mix between different media genres. So how to handle these multiple media genres? Because obviously when people are looking at these things, they come with expectations. Even though we don't necessarily talk about, a lot of people don't think about genres in their everyday life. But they have some media expectations. And what is it? Is it literature, or is it video, or a lot of these works are a mix of different genres, or connecting to different genres. So I think there needs to be done quite a bit of reworking.
And as a designer, I have used the horizon of expectations that you can use as a designer. You can actually use that to build the expectations and guiding the experience through using different genres or other related media texts.
In Gardner,
yes,
traditional German reception theory.
Because I was earlier I was really fond of reception theory. Because I was really interested of I would give you a bit background, so I was interested about how actually the audiences are changing, that was mine, and how they actually perceive media, and it's been an evolution,
And so. But the most connection to this is the producers of these videos and movies on the internet, they don't start from zero, they start from some sort of knowledge about what the movie would be. They have been looking at YouTube, they knew something, and they are part of this passive format knowledge they have. So you have to, in a way, beware of that they are both producers and consumers at the same time.
Yeah.
And they have a great knowledge. Even if they can't just spell it out, they knew a lot about formats and genres and things like that.
And for this is the interpretation in the hopefully forthcoming article. This interpretation is that this we try to make sense of the media landscape or the media all the time. And of course, we are influenced by the media around us. And what I found actually quite funny now is that these examples that I showed you where the, some data sets have been aggregated to be part of this video content, they all look the same. They are using the same format more or less. And so that is a great challenge for interaction designers to find new ways of communicating this, because it has become a norm already in 5 months. This kind of way of representing this.
Even the designers are part of the culture.
Yes, we are, yeah.
Yes. And have a lot of knowledge when they start designing.
Yeah, of course. Yes. Everybody, we are. We're not isolated or island. I have many other slides, but carry on. Yeah, please.
I was thinking another issue for that I would think would be an important point to analyze or put, add to your list is temporality. And that can be on various levels, but some things are meant to happen slowly over a long time, and that affects. But then you have the opposite, which is fascinating. You see these new practices of remixing, like eclectic method, the British guys who kind of, they feed on stuff, you know, from, they look at like what are the news clips and stuff being published today, and they incorporate it in their live DJing sessions 8 hours later, and it's just like, you know, it's this performative monolith database, you know, it's just, it's like media is being, it's, you know, you can shape it and sculpt it totally in a totally different way than you could 5 years back. And
have you ever seen them live?
No.
I have one.
Okay.
It is magnificent. How much time do we have? Just
another half an hour.
Okay. Briefly, I could probably. We can come back to this. I'm still in doubt, and I would ask your advice on this because, in order to understand the media environment and the different. Media practices, content, and so forth. I have found two different approaches to understand the environment or the interactions or the systems. And one is these digital ecosystems or social technical ecosystems, and they're using active network theory. Or then there is this media ecology. I'm happy that you see Parita is actually coming tomorrow, I guess, so I can ask his opinion. But this is something that I'm now struggling with, a bit like what kind of approach to this, the whole landscape one should take, because I think they are quite different. If you have any good ideas, you can please tell me. There are just a few, it doesn't really, it's not the informative illustrations, but also when I will show you some of the examples that I tried to do to discuss my own, how I understand my role as a media designer through a few case examples. But For example, one of them is that I try to support and stimulate and facilitate the legal creative reuse of audiovisual media. And therefore, I need, as a designer, I need to understand the laws and the policies and other stakeholders that might have interest to it. And so it's this design space that is quite enormous. And in the article that I mentioned earlier, we tried to promote or suggest that we should expand the design space also to accommodate the different design and use activities and other people. But now I'm also thinking like how to take into account the other stakeholders and the laws and policies, because they're really related to, my work is really related to copyright law and so forth. So it's a quite big area. But I'm just briefly gonna, before we go to the mapping, I know we don't really have time now, but two examples that I'm claiming that I have done media design. They're from the other ends, and I chose them because of these polar, the other ends of the spectrum. One is the Fusion software. It was a project that one aim was to design a social media application toolkit for communities to build their own applications, share media, and privately or publicly, and so forth. And the other one is this Remix Helsinki initiative that aims to facilitate and promote and support creative audiovisual activities. And the different methods and different the process is quite different. This was a co-design and participatory design process where we designed different tools and ways of people to engage in a really early phase in the design process. So to understand their media practices and develop their media practices along the project, and also so that the process and the practices would co-evolve with the software. And of course, we also, I believe that the media designers can also design practices together with people or communities and so forth. We identified some of the practices that this Parkour community had to organize jamming sessions, they call. It meant that they wanted to organize hopping around in the city and invite people and make their own videos, and how they could actually do it, how to make the, how this software could be so flexible that it would also accommodate this wish or need. So there is many different roles as a designer, doing the actual design, taking the co-design process and creating tools for the co-design, but actually doing the design. At the other end is more soft design, I would say, is this Remix Helsinki. When the other one was more creating tools and means for people to create and interact with the software and socially in their communities, this is actually how to help people to make remixes and mashups, and how to facilitate this, and what actually practitioners need to be able to make these outcomes, if you like. We had VJs, three people could do VJing thing, and then the traditional remixes. And what my role there was to provide information about different licenses, like what licenses the content is used, provide the resources, of course assist with the actual media design, but also with the process and how many of them work in pairs and so forth, so how to facilitate. And one of the goals as media designer was that we made interviews and we tried to understand what is the actual process and the practice of creating a remix or mashup. And to take this knowledge to our another design activity and how to transfer this knowledge to this design. And then the outcome was, of course, the final event and the remixes, but for us, quite a lot of insight about the practices. And actually, without designing anything concrete, we designed the interactions and the connections and maybe even influenced a bit about the project, the process and the practices. I don't know how we should continue because I thought that this would take 30 minutes, but okay, I'm just gonna, there's a quote from Faust, one of the articles, and he says that the media designer is rarely active in designing media in the sense that he is devising digital media into the preferred one as the digital medium is rarely redesigned or changed. And the media designer as found currently is merely focused to change the media carried by the digital media, such as images and so forth. I don't believe that at all. I like everything that I have earlier said disagrees with this, or I try to claim that is actually what the media designers should do and they are doing at the moment. And they design structures, functions, and in addition to media artifacts and so forth. So now if we're supposed to start the mapping, so what is the role, content, artifacts, strategies, and principles? Maybe we don't have time to do it, but I will show you my initial suggestions of the different dimensions. This I have done with some participation platforms or video sharing services because I've studied how they function and how they have set their policies and so forth, and how actually open or closed they are, and how independent or collaborative the process of creation is. And it's actually quite revealing because this hype about participation culture, for example, is so enormous that everybody should come and participate and do and share and so forth. But many times they, for example, if I would create a video and I would put it in the Stroom video sharing service, they would take all my rights to the content. So there are underlining designs of agreements, community guidelines that actually are also influencing the media content. The other dimensions about the mapping media design, about the social aspect also, like how the interaction and the designs for single or the individual, or is it the social and this social design for social ability. And are we actually creating media texts or tools? And then the third one is the role. And I would probably want to hear your, because I think everybody of us has some kind of a understanding of their role in the field. So I would like to hear maybe about this, your comments. Where would you position yourself, and are these dimensions relevant in your work? So it starts from the observe study. It's a bit vague, but actually being outside of the or maybe in the inside of the community, but more gaining information or knowledge. and facilitate and or stimulate as more an active role, and then at the other end is design and create. And like I said, I think that the media content actually has both the structures and the artifacts. So is it that we are doing the media text as a, or more the tools?
I have a question. Mm-hmm. I mean, concerning your own role here, because you use the term media designer and you're a researcher. And I can't really see how these two concepts, how you look upon these two positions. Because I guess there are two positions. To be a media designer, professional media designer, and come in to some kind of Helsinki remix as a researcher and media designer. Are these the same roles or positions?
That is example was easier to answer because I was one of the initiators of the remix Helsinki.
As a researcher?
As a, I would say, design researcher.
Okay, so the same. Your position is the same.
Yeah. But my role, I was quite clear in that one particular workshop, why am I there, and what kind of knowledge and experience and insights I'm trying to
get. For my field, I'm a literary researcher, so I would talk about the ideal type roles, and I would talk about the professional roles. And to me, they're not the same. This discussion to me is more like we're discussing ideal type media designer. And to me, that's a conceptual problem for me. And it's a methodological problem for me as well, because what am I supposed to talk about then? I mean, I guess it's a similar question as was asked before. Is this normative or is this descriptive? So are you talking about the professional media designer? Because I guess, I'm not aware of this, but I guess the professional media designer is funded by example, by company. And you're
a bit louder.
Okay. And I guess the time you have to finish a project is it's very short, I guess, compared to writing a PhD. About the role of media designers. You have practiced 4 years and you're already funded, and you have and the university as an institution is a completely different institution than a company, for instance. So I mean, that's why I'm asking this kind of question. So what kind of media designers are you talking about here?
When I approach a media design, my research is project driven and more practice based, so I draw the insights from the cases that I have chosen. So and there, with that knowledge, I claim to say or contribute something to the discussion of the media designer. I'm not able to say something definite and what is media designer per se, but I think I can make some contributions through the different cases and positions. I hope that is my intention.
Because positions in the field, if we're talking about Gombeau, from a sociological perspective, they differ a lot.
Yeah.
Depending on where you position yourself, but where you are to position, and so forth. So there's a lot of different algorithms here too.
So therefore I say about the... I like order. I have... and the capital and the power structures and that they were quite useful concepts. And I used it in my first MA thesis. So, but in this way, I don't know how far I can go because there are cases in a way. Of course, in the beginning, I have to describe the situation, and I have been fortunate to have this. Not commissioned design jobs that I'm using. Of course, they were EU funded, but not as tight as the company. But of course, my relationship with the communities that I've been working with, another other stakeholders and project partners, of course, I need to map this. It's very complicated.
I mean, that's really complicated concepts to use.
Yeah. I know. It's maybe I should reconsider the role, or maybe talk about activities. Because with the role, I mean, I think it's because there's this discussion about being interaction designers and the media scholars and other fields that are their intersection. So of course in that framework or landscape, I am trying to position myself and try to find ways how to operate and claim my role in a way. So also this is maybe it's also claiming a role that is not existing yet, that I can say that I'm doing this.
Yeah.